So, ladies and gentlemen, today we are going to discuss something very important related to the 11th house. That is why I have named this video as The Untold Secrets of the 11th House. And there are many things which I will say here which you might already know, but there is one big secret which I will reveal, which will not only help you in your astrological pursuits, in the study of astrology, or during consultations, but it will help you always in every walk of your life, and it is a very, very, very important thing to learn, which I have learned from many of my seniors and my gurus. And today, here is the secret. It's not a secret, everybody knows it, but the problem is nobody uses it, okay? And unless you tell that it's a secret, then nobody is wanting to hear from you, all right? So today we will reveal that secret of the 11th house, because it's the most important house in the horoscope. All right, why do I say this? Well, we will discuss about that today in this video. Okay, so there you go. If you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me regarding your 11th house or any other house, then you can always go down to the description section of my videos, where you will find the link to my website to book a reading with me personally. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. No, you don't find him. We are going to discuss about him today, okay? Because whatever I speak today, I will base it on the Srimad Bhagavatam, the last shloka of the entire Srimad Bhagavatam. All right, so I will give the reference down. If somebody is interested, they can go and have a look at this shloka. But today what I want to share is, what is the 11th house? Now, there is a major controversy about the 11th house. Yes, Jaimini says that the I don't remember, is it Jaimini or Parashara, one of the two, they say that Tano Tana Dandahara Tano. Okay, this means that 11th house is like punishment. Okay, but why is it said that 11th house is the house of punishment? But 11th house is a great house. If you see, when you are doing predictive astrology, if a person has a planet in the 11th house and the dasha is running, the Antar Dasha or Mahadasha, then you can see great success in all areas of life. Okay, or the lord of the 11th house, it is even more powerful than the 10th lord. It is said that the planet in the 11th house is three times more stronger than the planet in the 10th house for career. Okay, and it is three times more stronger than the planet in the 7th house to give you marriage. My God, it's even stronger than the 7th house for marriage. Okay, and for all areas of life, 11th house is the best house to have planets. But why is it said that it is a house of punishment? Or rather, I would say, how can we make it the best house, okay, rather than seeing it as a house of punishment? Well, first let's discuss why it is known as the house of punishment, because it's the house of desire. Yes, and that is what punishes us. Because who is the 11th lord? It is Saturn and it is Rahu, because Rahu rules the sign Aquarius along with Saturn. Do not forget that, okay? So that means these two are the most malefics. I have made a lot of videos on Saturn and Rahu, but when I say that they are malefics, many people think that, oh, he's simply criticizing Rahu, or he's criticizing Saturn, or he's criticizing the traits of Rahu. No, what I mean is the natural traits of Rahu, which is materialistic desire, okay, which gives us sleepless nights, which does not let us be in peace, which ruins our mental peace. That's what Rahu represents. Rahu represents those things which, even if we do not have in life, it will not affect us, but we still need it. Okay, and Rahu is the karaka for addictions and everything. But there's something very beautiful. Rahu is essentially the age of Kali Yuga, okay, which started when roughly Lord Krishna left this world 5,000 years back, roughly that time. And now, in this age of Kali, Rahu is very prominent, he is the kingmaker. So, that essentially means wherever Rahu is placed is the most important house in your chart. But let's go to that some other day. But today, let's discuss on the natural lordship of Rahu. That means, in Kali Yuga, not the ascendant, not the moon, the 11th house is like the ascendant. Should I repeat? The 11th house is like the ascendant. And I will reason it from the Srimad Bhagavatam. I will explain it to you why I am saying what I am saying. Okay. There is nothing of my own here. Now, what a controversial statement it is to make that 11th house is like the ascendant. Wow. I mean, 11th house is the 11th house of the ascendant, right? It's the gain of the ascendant. But why do I say it behaves like the ascendant, or it is more powerful than the ascendant? So essentially, if you want to know somebody's nature, it is highly, highly, highly important to know the planet sitting in the 11th, or the 11th lord, or the planets aspecting the 11th house. Okay, now you may be thinking, how in the universe will it be like the ascendant lord? Because they say that the planet in the ascendant is like the planet in the head. Okay, that planet is the most prominent, good or bad, either ways. All the Raj Yogas, they are defined from the ascendant, because from the ascendant you will define which planet is ruling the Kendras and the Trikonas, and by that you get Raj Yogas. But why do I say that in Kali Yuga, 11th house is 10,000 billion trillion times or unlimited times more important than the ascendant? Because it is the house of association. All right, and association defines who we are. Okay, so therefore the scriptures say tano tana danda hara tano. It means that our association has the power to make us or break us. Okay, so it means the people who we associate with, they will ultimately shape us. Okay, because many times people have this confusion that which is more important, the ascendant or moon sign. Okay, so in Kali Yuga, the ascendant sign is more important, because in Kali Yuga everybody is becoming more individualistic, they are becoming more self-centric, self-centered, self-obsessed. But in the earlier ages, it was the moon, the society. People would follow the terms of the society, the norms of the society. But nowadays, hardly anybody is doing that. Everybody is just hell-bent on breaking traditions, just for the sake of breaking. Okay. So because of that, the ascendant is important, more important than the moon. But the 11th house is even more important than the ascendant, because that will tell us what kind of people we will sit with. Okay, who we will sit with. So that is why the placement of Jupiter or Sun or Moon, these three sattvic planets in the 11th house, is considered exceptional, I have seen, in my opinion. Why? Because these three are the sattvic planets, especially Jupiter or Moon. Okay, Sun has some of Rajas also, and therefore these three planets, when they are placed in the 11th house, it means as if these three are sitting in his ascendant. Okay, so now you may be thinking, but maybe this is in their ascendant, or maybe this is in the 11th. How does it make a difference? Well, it makes a huge difference, because if it is in the ascendant, that is why they say Jupiter gets Digbala in the Lagna, because then the person's ability to seek higher knowledge is at its peak. But always remember, there are many people who start off with many spiritual practices, but there are a very few who can continue their spiritual practices. Okay, why? Have you ever wondered what is the reason that you, many people message me that I started with this mantra, I started with that fasting, I started reading the Ramayana, all the fancy stuff. Yes, and that's great, that's fantastic, that's the Lagna, that's the ascendant, you have taken initiative, that's you, very good. But after 2-3 months, they will again message me that, my dear sir, you told to do this mantra in your this video or during the consultation. I did, but then guy down the car has stopped. Why? Because in Kali Yuga we have to understand that we do not have strength, we do not have inner strength. That's a fact of Kali Yuga, because Vyasdev says, you know, Manda Sumanda Matayo, that sloka is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Yes, people do not have the intelligence which is required to pursue spiritual knowledge sufficiently. That's very unfortunate, but that's how the age of Kali is. And therefore, in the last canto, the last chapter, the last verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam, there is a very big secret which is revealed. Okay, And I will read that shloka directly, and I will also try to read part the translation. Okay, so I have it in front of me. But before speaking about this shloka, which speaks about the power of association, which means associating with good people or bad people, I will say there is another shloka in the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is a very famous shloka. Okay, where Parikshit Maharaj, who is hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam, he asks to Sukhdev Goswami that, "My dear Sukhdev Goswami, you have narrated the entire Srimad Bhagavatam to me. But unfortunately, I see that Kali Yuga is a very difficult age where religion and spiritual piety is falling all-time low. You can see it's all over the place. It's rampant. It's there in the movies. There is nudity, there is sexuality, there is drugs, there is cigarettes, there is wine, there is prostitution. It's rampant. There is no talk of God. There is no talk of spirituality. Is there something good at all about Kali Yuga?" Then Sukhdev Goswami takes the stand and he says, "There is one great quality. Yes, and that is a very, 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 very famous shloka. Kaler doshani dheerajan asti hiye kan mahat gunan kirtanadeva krishnasya mukta sanga param vrajet." Sukhdev Goswami says, "Kaler dosha nidhe rajan, my dear king, you are right. Kali Yuga is an ocean of faults. Okay, asti hi ekan mahat gunan, but there is one great, great, great quality. And what is that? Kirtana deva Krishnasya. When you chant the names of Krishna or Vishnu or Ram, mukta sanga param vrajet. Param, it means mukti from all the pangs and pains and sufferings of this material realm. Yes, that is the shloka. And in the last canto, the last verse, the last chapter, I will tell you what that shloka is. It's a very famous shloka. It is the last. Okay, so glories of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And I will paraphrase it in very short. The name of the shloka is Nama Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam Pranamo Dukkha Samanas Tam Namami Harim Param. So what does this shloka mean? This shloka means, "I offer my respectful obeisances unto the Supreme Lord Hari." It's referring to Lord Vishnu. "The congregational chanting of whose holy names destroy all sinful reactions." Should I repeat? Destroys all sinful reactions. "And the offering of obeisances unto whom relieves all material suffering." But my point here is, there's one word here which we need to highlight, and that is the word congregational. Okay, now what is congregational? Congregational has many meanings. One of the meanings is doing things together. Okay, so that means whenever we are starting anything good, we are doing anything good, spiritual, material, health, or whatever it is, okay, we need to ensure that we are staying with the people who are also tuning in that frequency. Okay, because otherwise, as I told you, in Kali Yuga, it is next to impossible that the ascendant survives, which means New Year resolutions. Okay, so just think, when 2019 started, you must have made a New Year resolution, right? 2019. But ask yourself now, are you able to follow it? Well, 90% of the people will write, "No, I'm not able to follow it." Why? Because that's how we are in Kali Yuga. We are helpless when we are alone. But when we do things together with people, or when we stay with people who are also tuning in that frequency, only then we can survive in Kali Yuga. When I say we can survive, I mean in our spiritual journey. Okay, so many times people tell me that, "I am doing this mantra in my home, I am doing this, I am doing that." That's perfectly fine, that's great, that's wonderful. You are doing, you are a rare species, you are, if you are doing that. I am not saying this. Krishna says, that Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakritim ashritam bhajanti ananya manaso gyatva bhutadim avyayam. Krishna also says, that manushyanam sahasreshu kaschit yatate siddhaye yatatam api siddhanam kaschin mam veti tattvatah. Okay, so manushyanam sahasreshu, one in thousand, they will inquire about me, and out of that one in that thousand, One will advance, and out of that one, of that thousand, one will reach me. So spiritual life in Kali Yuga is extremely difficult, okay? Because Kali Yuga is not meant for spiritual progress. It is meant for godless, headless, materialistic civilization. But as Sukhdev Goswami said, Kaler dosha nidhe rajan asti hi ekan mahadgunan kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sanga param rajit. So that means the planet which is there in the 11th house is like the kingmaker of the chart. Okay, now if there are many planets, then we might have to see which planet is stronger, okay, by sign or by other conditions. How is it placed in the Navamsha? Where is the 11th lord placed? Okay, but in general, I have seen if the 11th lord is connected with the 9th house, okay, which means the 9th lord is in the 11th, or the 11th lord is in the 9th, or there is a parivartan, yes, then great spiritual progress is indicated, because the same house of desire, which is the house of punishment, is now the house of greatest blessing, because now the person will desire to stay in company of spiritual people. Okay, so similarly, that is so similarly in any house you can take, okay, if it has a link with the 11th house, then those activities will be very prominent, because wherever we go, we will be surrounded by those people, what those houses represent. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say. And the last shloka says, you know, that congregational chanting. So it means whenever we start a spiritual practice, always remember that to continue, because one of my gurus used to say that in cricket, there is, you know, hitting fours, there is hitting six, there is 50, there is century. But in spiritual life, you don't have to hit a century. You don't have to hit a half century. You don't have to hit a six. You don't even have to hit a four boundary. You don't even have to run for one. What do you have to do then? Just be not out. Okay. So in spiritual life, if we remain not out, which means if we do not stop our spiritual progress, our activities, then it is a grand success. It is a huge success. The very fact that we are able to continue our spiritual journey is a great success. We may advance, we may not advance, that's secondary, okay? But if we are able to continue, then that itself is a great success. But for that, we have to be in the association of the right people. If we are with the right people, anything, if you are planning to do yoga, then you have to stay with people who are also interested in yoga, okay? But our problem is we do the opposite, okay? So for example, what we do is we will have all these fancy stuff, you know, all the spiritual stuff in our head which we want to do, and maybe we end up doing it, but then after some time, what we do? Oh, we will go and sit with the people who are watching cricket or who are watching reality shows, yes, in the TV, or they are watching football or anything like that, you know, all the useless boring stuff of this material world. That's what we keep doing all the time. So their association affects us, okay? So their poison also comes to us, right? And by that we destroy ourselves, and by that we ruin our spiritual practices. We stop doing spiritual practices. We cannot continue. Therefore, the takeaway from this video is that wherever you are, whoever you are, however you are, whichever stage of spirituality you are, it doesn't matter. The only thing matters is, are you in the right company? Okay. So in the weekends or every 3 months, you must go and visit spiritual communities where you can meet people who are also doing the same spiritual practice, or at least doing something. Okay. Because when you go there, you will most likely meet at least one or two people, at least, who are doing something spiritual, okay? It is better to meet at least one or two people every weekend, all right? By that, your conception of spirituality will be reinstantiated, and then that house, the 11th house, which is the house of punishment, will become the most important and the best and the most fulfilling house of all the 12 houses, okay? Otherwise, if we are indulging with people who are discussing about the opposite sex, about who is having an affair with whom, okay, discussing about the private parts of the opposite sex, then That is what will go inside. And then we will sit with the mala to do some mantra in the morning. And then you are like, oh, he said, you know, this person looks like this. You know, this person was wearing this. And then that is going on in your head. And then you are like, no, stop it. I need to watch something in the internet now. Okay. And that is the end of our spiritual life. Okay. So let us not associate ourselves with people who will drag us down. Let us associate with people who will uplift us, who will inspire us to do good, to be good, and to elevate our consciousness. Because ultimately, we are all spirit souls. Yes, as the Vedanta Sutra says, Raso Vaisaha, that the absolute truth, God, He is the emblem, He is the epitome of all the spiritual pleasures. It's like the word Rama, yes, Ram, that word itself means the emblem of all spiritual pleasures, you know, the source of all pleasure. That's what is the meaning of the word Ram. And the meaning of the word Krishna is one who is all attractive. Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Viryasya, that shloka is there. If you know, then you can write it down in the comments. Okay, so there you go. That's what is the 11th house. 11th house is the most important house, because that decides what will go inside your head. Okay, because that is what all the people are telling you, do this, do that, do this, do that, and that is what you will end up doing at the end of the day. Okay, so stay with good people, and only then we can retain our goodness. Okay, and only then we can aspire to be like somebody, for example Yudhishthira Maharaj, or we can aspire to be like one of the 12 Mahajans. Of course, we cannot be like them, but as the Bhagavatam itself says, Mahajano yena gata sapanta, that we should try to follow in the footsteps of the Mahajans. Okay, and the 12 Mahajans, they are mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Swayambhu Narada Shambhu Kumaro Kapilo Manu Prahlado Janako Bhishmo Balirvaya Sakivayam. Yamaraj is included in that. He is speaking about these great personalities to Yamadutas, alright, because the Yamadutas failed to bring Ajamil to the hellish planets. Why? Because Ajamil had chanted the name of Narayana once, only once he chanted, okay, and that freed him from all his sinful actions. So we will discuss on Ajamil. This story is there in the 6th canto. Am I right? 6th canto, maybe. If I am wrong, you can write it down which canto it is. In my knowledge, it is in the 6th canto. And you can study, you can read about Ajamil, okay, how he was spoiled, and later on how Lord Vishnu had saved him at the end. Okay, so that is it from my side. That is the conclusion about the 11th house. So if you are new, then please subscribe to the channel, and if you like this video, click the thumbs up and share it with somebody who is interested to know about the 11th house. And if you want a consultation from me regarding the 11th house or any other house or any other aspect in your life, then you could always go down to the description section of my videos, where you will find the link to my website to book a reading with me personally. Okay, God is there with you all the time. No, don't look inside, go outside to spiritual communities and look, only then you will find him. Okay, thank you very much.